public service. Tonight's meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals is being recorded for RCTV live. Comcast Channel 99, looks like 99, or Verizon Channel, looks like 32. The videographer for tonight's meeting is Marcel. Check rctv.org for more information and for replay times. All right, one case on the docket tonight. Go ahead and read it into the record. Case 1702, Zoning Board of Appeals will hold a public hearing in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Town Hall on Thursday, April 20th, 2017 at 7 p.m. on the petition of David Vivalecchia. You'll let me know if I got that right. Who seeks a variance under section 6.0, table 6.3 of the zoning bylaws in order to add an addition of 29 by 6 feet by 24 by 3 feet, a garage, to the left side with a setback of 10 foot rather than the required 15 foot as per a plan on the property located at 271 Franklin Street, Reading, Massachusetts. Unless there's an objection, I'll dispense with the reading of the abutters list, except to say that the abutters were notified, as were the following boards and committees: Board of Selectmen, Police Department, Building Department, Health Department, Engineering Division, CPDC, Assessor's Office, Conservation Commission, Fire Department, and Town Clerk, members and associate members of this board, as well as the planning boards of surrounding communities. Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you're going to speak tonight, please stand and raise your right hand and be sworn, please. That includes the applicant, sir, yes. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is I do.
I do.
Okay, sir, you are the applicant. The floor is yours.
All right. Good evening, thank you. I'm David Vivalecchia. My wife and I and my two children live at 271 Franklin Street, and we've been there for a little over 15 years now. So we're before you because we're looking to obviously put in a garage, and as it stands now, we have two sheds. I'd like to get rid of one of the sheds. It's kind of an eyesore, and get some storage outside as well as room for my wife's minivan or SUV. So what we're looking for is relief on obviously on the 15 foot side setback. We're looking for at most 5 feet relief, and at least on one point of the garage, a little less than 3 feet. The garage itself is 24 by 30, 24 feet wide in the front, and it's really an 18-foot garage. The reason is the 6 foot set in from the side of the house is kind of required because of where the chimney exists and where existing windows exist. Would require a lot of a change to the existing structure to slide that over, and so to adequately get a large vehicle and some storage space, 18 feet seemed to be the right amount after doing a lot of research. If you look at the property, I don't know if anybody had a chance to get out there and visit, but if you look at the property, there's it's kind of a tough lot. It's sloped. It has a big slope from the north side to the south side of the property. In the back, there isn't a lot of room out back outside of where existing things are to put another structure, or if you did, it wouldn't be aesthetically pleasing for the neighborhood. On the other side of the property, that's again sloping down towards the house, there's very little room, and it would require a new curb cut. So to put the garage anywhere else on the property really would be infeasible from a cost standpoint and probably from a destruction standpoint, and really wouldn't look good in the neighborhood. So we're looking for relief, and in doing so, we've kind of looked at the neighborhood, and as you folks probably know, Franklin Street's kind of a mismatch of all different houses from all different eras, and there's lots of examples of houses that don't necessarily meet the conformity of the zoning restrictions today. So we don't think it really would be out of character for the neighborhood. Even with the garage, we're still going to have at least 50 feet clearance between our house and the house directly to the left side of the property. I've also spoken to both abutting neighbors on the left and right side of the property, and both, you can see, have letters in support. From what I heard, I haven't heard any neighbors in objection to it. And the last thing, I guess, is, again, the size of what we need, it's required, we're requiring it kind of the family, because if you go in my house, the house has been constructed, I think reconstructed several times over a long period of time. The records show it is in the 50s, but it's got to be way before that, because you go down the basement and it's in just the old foundation, and half the house is on slab, and half of it's kind of in a different level basement. So there isn't a lot of good storage. It's wet down there, and we're kind of running out of a lot of space, but, you know, obviously with kids and all the stuff that they're involved in, and desire to get a garage to kind of improve the property, and, you know, they have the convenience of that. So that's really, I mean, I'm asking, you know, you folks for a favor to try to help us get this in. I'm open for questions if you have any, but that's really all I have.
All right, thanks very much. Typically, we next open the hearing to questions, comments from board members, and we typically start with Robert. Do you have any questions or comments for the applicant?
Sure, I do. Quickly going through this, and as you said, we went up and took a look at the property and saw it. It is in the S20 zoning district. Requires 120-foot frontage, 20,000 square foot lot area, and it is less than that in both those criteria. So it's considered a legal non-conforming lot, I believe, on that it would be considered. And right now, your structure on the lot does conform to all side yards. Other than the lot area and lot frontage, you have the structure itself conforms to all setbacks and everything. Yeah, and you're looking for a one-car garage, right? Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. I noticed that the code enforcement officer, in his denial of your application and telling you that you had to come for a variance here to the Board of Appeals, noted that you are in the aquifer protection area and that you have to give us, or you have to show on your plot plan what your percentage of impervious area is on your lot. Now, I did not see that at all on your plot plan on that. And it cannot exceed your impervious area in the aquifer protection zone. Cannot exceed 2,500 square feet or 15% of the lot unless there is a system of artificial recharge on the lot. I assume you don't have that now.
Not currently.
No, on that. So that is one thing that I think has been omitted that we would want to see is your impervious areas, and that includes, you know, your structures.
Yeah.
Your driveways, walkways, decks, patios, anything like that. Paved driveways, yeah, decks, basketball. I saw you had a basketball court out in back. That needs to be included. Anything that's impervious needs to be included in that figure.
That's not that. The 12.1% that they put on here as proposed lot coverage?
No, that says that, proposed
that's
lot coverage.
That's just the lot coverage.
That's your major structure.
Okay.
That's your structure. Your house.
Okay.
And I assume that would be also the proposed garage that you're planning.
Yeah, that would, yeah,
that would be your lot coverage.
Okay.
Okay.
So the additional things would be the driveway.
Paved driveways, any paved walkways, sheds.
Deck.
So even if it's open underneath, it's still considered impervious.
Patio. Anything that's paved over, anything, has to be included in that, on that. It appears to me, looking at the photographs and being out at the site, that you do have in excess of 15% of impervious area on your property. With the driveway coming in, walkways, the sheds, the patio in back, patio, I guess it's patio / basketball.
Right. Well, no. If you went back there, you wouldn't call it a patio. But thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. So you do need that. Now, keep in mind that the proposed garage is going to create a new non-conformity on this. Now, we have a piece of property with a structure on it that conforms to all setbacks. Now you're asking for a variance to create a new non-conformity here. Very difficult to get. And you have to meet the four criteria required by a variance, that's state law. And if you would want to go through those criteria, that would be fine. I think the board would like to hear your arguments for each one of those criteria on it. Personally, I find the hardship one the more difficult one on that one. And it's typically number one is the more difficult one, which is the hardship due to, you know, that's the only spot you could do this and why you actually need a variance. And it isn't necessarily just because I would like to put in a garage on that, and so I need a variance. It doesn't cut it. You have to really prove why you would like this garage and what is stopping you from building it anywhere else or building it in the dimensions that you have on that. So that's what you're going to need to prove to us.
So would you like me to elaborate on that?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
So,
go right through the four criteria.
So, I mean, as far as related to number one, describe the circumstances related to the soil conditions, shape, topography. I think I mentioned that if you look at the property, the grid majority of the property is of a drastic slope. There's very, you know, if you look at the actual lot size, probably, you know, a good less than a third, if not more, of the property is not usable because of that. So any other place to put it would be really difficult to do based on the size of the property and what's currently available for us.
Well, I think any other place that you put it, if you put it on the, what would be the easterly side of your house, maybe it wouldn't fit in right. I don't know what your interior of your house, that is. I'm assuming you're putting the garage on the kitchen side of the house.
That's right.
And that's where typically most people would put it.
Yeah.
And that's the most natural place for it. But in this particular case, for the garage and the dimensions that you want, you need a variance, so it may be difficult to put it there.
Yeah, that's right. That's kind of right.
Yeah.
So based on the topography of the land, where our current curb cut is, it would be extremely costly to put it anywhere else on the property because it would require a lot of earthwork, a lot of retaining walls. I mean, there's ledge in that area. I know, for example, because the people did a house up in back of me and they spent a lot of money, extra money, dealing with ledge. So I know there's ledge there. I know it probably doesn't meet the criteria, but probably from the aesthetics of the neighborhood, it probably really wouldn't look very good slapping a garage right in the middle of the backyard, even if we wanted to do that. But basically, the cost of it would be really astronomical. To put it on the other side of the property, there's even less usable space on that because that property comes straight down, probably to about 10 feet off the side of the foundation. So you would be abutting a land that comes straight down, and we would require us remodeling our whole home to make it work inside. So cost-wise, it would be an extreme hardship to do it. We have looked at all the different options, and you know, cost-wise, there really is no. I mean, yeah, it would be nice to have it there, and I'm not going to lie and say that we want it there. But even if you look at the property, really, there isn't really any other spot to put it. Even if there was an option, even if price wasn't an issue. As far as the literal enforcement of the ordinance, would that affect the, a lot of these seem to be kind of the same thing where it's, mm-hmm. it's a lot of the hardship that's going to put on you if you defy the literal enforcement of the law. And of the zoning requirement, and I have to come back to
the property, and it's not a really, it's not a real, you know, I don't want to say normal lot, but it's a tough lot. You know, it's got really bad grading issues. It tapers in the back, it's on a, you know, it's on a slight curve, so it tapers drastically in the back. So we do lose, lot dimension as you go back on the property. It's not, yeah, this, you know, and the house is the way, the house is set the way it is, so there's not a lot we could do as far as that is now, to change that without spending a lot of money. And at that point, you would probably end up, probably make more sense just to rip the thing down and start anew, and that's, I mean, that's not gonna happen. So, you know, I'm here because, you know, we like the area, you know, our kids go to school up in the Wood End, all their friends are around, we want to stay in there. Very difficult, as you know, to find another home in Reading. If we could, we would, you know, but, you know, it's, we're just looking to have a little bit more convenience, space, without spending a tremendous amount of money. And that's, I mean, that's really what it is. I mean, I understand the lot coverage and all that stuff, and I most certainly can have my surveyor take care of that, because that's a requirement, but, you know, it's, there's really no other choice I have. I've gone through this with my, you know, with my surveyor, couple of my engineer friends, and I haven't, there's really not a lot I can do without spending a lot more money. Mm-hmm. That, you know, at that point, it's really not worth it. So,
The total width of your garage, though, is, I'm looking at that, it's over 24 feet, 24.3
yeah.
feet.
And I know I explained
it's a single car garage.
And a good portion of that is because of, I have to set it in because of where, how the chimney's structured and the windows are structured on that side of the house. Again, it would require a lot. It's not gonna be necessarily usable. You're gonna walk in and go up the stairs. It's still gonna be, you know, really 18 feet outside, but inside, obviously, it's a lot smaller than that. And from the research that I've done, that's adequate for a large SUV and a minivan,
right,
and some storage, so.
And I realize you're also looking for storage space, as you know.
Oh, no, it's definitely, yeah.
Assuming that's what a lot of the garage is gonna be used for, too, is for storage.
Hopefully, there'll be some room left after the car gets in there, yeah. Yeah, hopefully.
Okay.
There's stuff everywhere.
Okay, yeah, that's, if you wanted to, and I know the other four criteria, you've talked about the first two criteria in your variance. The other two criteria have to do with, you know, in regards to public good and also with degrading from the zoning bylaws.
As far as public good, I don't think it would be out of character for the neighborhood. I mean, I know, you know, driving, you know, being there for 15 years and knowing the area, there's lots of examples along Franklin Street and other areas around where there are properties that are much, you know, encroach much more in the zoning setbacks than this would. It wouldn't, you know, I think it would improve the look of the property personally. And it would, you know, it would not be out of character for the neighbor. So I don't see how it, I don't necessarily see how it would be a detriment to the meaning of the law, mm-hmm. Of the rule, so.
Okay, thank you. That's it.
Anything else, Robert?
That's it for now, David, yeah.
Okay. Kathy?
I had the same concern about the plot plan, so that would be good to see that.
Okay.
And right now, I don't have any additional. It sounds like, from what you're saying, you're putting the garage where you have proposed due to the condition of the lot.
Yeah.
And that seems to be, from what you're saying, the only feasible space at this point for you to put it.
Okay. That's right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kathy. John?
Well, as Robert mentioned, in the denial letter by the zoning enforcement building inspector / building inspector. He does mention the aquifer protection area, and is in looking at the property in lieu of what you had mentioned in your description, I found it difficult to see any outcroppings of ledge except to the possible right where the hillside is, and perhaps in the back. If there is indeed ledge back there, we're talking about a lot that has a lot of area that is encumbering the aquifer protection district. And when you look at the coverage that you're proposing here, we're looking to increase our area by roughly 720 square feet by placing the garage on the lot, attaching it to the house. I don't know where that aspect of it, since you didn't provide anything from the engineering, I find it very difficult to see what the impact would be to the impervious surfaces. The second concern that I had was the size of the garage also. We're talking about a 30-foot deep garage with roughly 24 feet wide, even with the small 6-foot by 6-foot entryway between the house and the garage, for the protection of the chimney. And that portion, when I looked at and saw the chimney, I said, what are they going to do with the chimney? But you're talking about a one-car garage with storage. You have basically a one-car garage that is almost three times a one-car garage in area. And I'm finding it difficult when I go back to look at the four criteria for the variance, where you could not cut that down and meet the 15-foot setback even in the rear by moving that forward a little bit and off to the side by taking the 24 feet off of it. The issue with variances are that once you create one, it's not like a special permit, you can't take it back
again. I understand.
You can't modify it either once it's up. So the issue is how do you cover those criteria, and the first criteria happens to be the locus of the house or the structure on the property and the soil conditions. And right now, when looking at it, I couldn't see any outcroppings of ledge. But in essence, when you're looking at the house, the proposed house and garage final structure, you're looking at a massive frontage. I would hate to say curbside appeal, but that garage that's proposed would take up more than three quarters of the frontage that you have right now, and you're short on the S20 zone by roughly 13 feet. So I'm concerned that right now, by doing what you're proposing, the 10-foot is a fairly substantial, or an encroachment of another 5 feet on the 15-foot setback is a fairly substantial increase. And not only are you increasing it there, but you're increasing it on the front by 2.5 feet. So I'm having trouble with the first and probably the second. In terms of the third criteria, character of the basically character of the neighborhood, yes, up until recently, when we had two additional homes partially torn down and rebuilt, or in the rebuilding stages, they all small ranch style. They went up on the hillside. Of course, you go up to 30 feet or the 35 feet, and you're talking about a 12 foot off, 10 to 12 foot off the roadway to begin with. They become massive, so the neighborhood is changing, I agree. But it's only that section of Franklin Street that is really changing. So I'm having trouble with a number of the criteria in the variance right now. And I don't know. I think it's difficult for a board member to propose that you decrease the size of what you're asking for, and what that would, what result that would show on your certified plot plan in your proposal, but still it would be a variance, and that's, I guess, what I'm coming down to. I'm thinking that the one-car garage is what you're asking for, and I know the storage, but you have that shed on the side too, and as you said, that's going, but it also could go in the back of the house also, so. I guess right now, those are my instincts relative to your request for the variance.
Thanks, John. Si.
Just a couple of points of clarification, which may not have any significant bearing on things, but there are two sheds there now, right?
Yeah.
How close are those to the lot line?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure of that answer.
Are they in the vicinity of the 10 feet, or are they further in?
I don't know. I don't have the answer to that.
Now, what, the first one's coming down?
Closest to the street. No, the closest one closest to the street would go.
The other one's going to stay there.
Yeah.
And the fencing on that side of the
property, that's not
was your neighbor's fencing.
That's the neighbor's fencing.
I noticed the plot plan is dated February of 2016.
Mm-hmm.
You've been thinking about this for a long time.
Yeah.
What prevented you from moving forward at that time?
Life.
Life.
It's stuff, work, you know, all of it. It's it. Yeah.
Yeah. Have you ever thought about moving that garage a little forward into the front of the property?
Towards the street?
Mm-hmm.
We looked at it and didn't think it would look very well. You would have very little driveway, and that would, you'd almost be sitting on top of Franklin Street, which...
No, you had 41 feet there.
Well, it really would be up on Franklin Street. And it, even if we did that, you know, you'd still have to have that jog in because of the way the existing house is set, the side window there. You can't abut it, you know, flush to the house. Without having
well,
to
I realize
change.
That. There's
so I know it just it didn't aesthetically it didn't seem like it would would look good.
The only other comment I would have at this time is I agree totally with Bob's comment about the impervious compliance.
Okay.
Which really isn't shown anywhere.
Okay. Yeah. No. I thought that wasn't brought to my attention. I thought we were just outside the aquifer protection. When I looked at the map online, my lot was just outside of it. That's why I was curious as to that.
Mm. Well,
I mean, I'll take your word for it.
Do we have an overlay as part of the package? I didn't see one.
I don't know.
I know when I went online and looked at
the
map.
That's going by what obviously the code enforcement officer noted to you in his letter.
No, did he?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. In his denial, his building permit review dated January 31st, 2017. He cited that the property is in an AQ district, aquifer protection AQ.
Yeah, I didn't. if I find different, can we have that altered if it isn't according to the map? Because I don't think it is.
We can't do that here.
Yeah.
But certainly that would be something that we would recommend.
Not that the impervious, I can absolutely have the surveyor or the engineer take care of the impervious. I'll absolutely do that. So
if you're in the aquifer protection district.
I'll do it either way. I mean, it's
well, your surveyor can find that. He can generally lay that out, get that squared away.
Yep. Okay. Okay.
I'm sorry.
Part of his rejection.
Right.
This was saying that the plot plan must indicate the lot coverage of the impervious surfaces, and it doesn't.
Right.
And I think we need that.
Yeah, and I think that would be one of the, well, go ahead, Zai. I'll summarize when it comes back to me.
I'm done at the moment.
Thank you, Zai. Eric.
So, I mean, I know you're probably getting a lot of feedback from the board, and Really, what you're asking for is an exception to whatever everyone else in the town can do with the bylaws. So to actually be able to sign off on that, we need to reach these four criteria. That's what the state law is. That's what the bylaws also mirror. And so it would be helpful, and because you're going to have to come back again anyway with the new plan, if we could get some more information on why it can't be to the right. And I know that your kitchen isn't there, but you know, you mentioned the potential for ledge there. If you were able to, like, really, like, specify and quantify what the actual challenges are there, I think that it would be a lot more persuasive that it has to be on the other side of the house. Really, in concert with that is you have an ambitious project for a one-car garage. So, you know, obviously, we're raising the question of, is that, you know, do you have to have it be that big? And obviously, you know, your family is, you know, is what's dictating that, but we have to go by what's in the zoning bylaws. Like, is that a good enough reason, because you want it, to not have it comply with what everyone else has to comply with? So those are just some things, you know, just to have in the back of your mind while you're working with your, you know, surveyor to come back with the revised plan is, can I move it? You know, can I make a really good argument and have something submitted to the board in terms of why it can't happen? I mean, I know you note here that, you know, this option was determined to be undesirable and uneconomical. Those are, at least for me, a little too vague to actually say, yep, okay, then you met the criteria. It'd be helpful if we just had something for the record. And that's all I have.
Thanks, Eric. Nick?
So can I just clarify one?
Sure.
So when you is that when you're saying that, you mean to more on the right hand side to quantify?
Yeah, well, I mean,
some of the cost or some of the length.
Sure, I mean, because I'm looking at it, right, and you have on the side that you want to put it in, looks like you've got about 25 and a half feet, or just shy of that, to that wall line. You've got 31.2 feet on the other side. So you could potentially have the same dimensions that you want. I mean, I can't quite tell because the house is a little askew and I don't have the full you know, side setbacks there. But you could have pretty close to what you're looking for on the right side dimensionally. I mean, obviously that's not where you want it because it's not where the kitchen is, but you know, if there's a reason that it can't go there because there actually is ledge and you've had somebody go out there and can submit a report, that is very persuasive because, you know, if you can't do it there, really the only other option is the other side, which is where you want to do it. But again, the reason that you're here today is not just because you want to do it on that side, but because of the scale that you want to do that. So I mean, that, I guess that's where I'm going with that.
Thank you.
So.
Thanks. All right, Nick.
I do share much of the sentiment of the board. I think reading through this, there's a lot in here that starts to build a really strong argument of why it should go in that location. I was reading the property card. It talks about having a sub pump on that property and maybe water, and because of that you have a lack of storage in the basement, and this would provide some much needed storage. I talked about the neighborhood character, the curb cut being where it is, that would make the most ideal sense to put that garage. You talked about the mature trees and the small lot size. I thought that was very compelling to that, but what some of the other members said was there's also anticipated ledge. Well, we don't know for sure, so we really want to know, you know, put that nail in the coffin that we already looked into, and it sounds like you've already done a bunch of research. But just, you know, documenting it and maybe just taking that additional extra step to really telling us why that location is the best, and also that size. Because, you know, when I was looking at the plot plan, relatively, it is a very large garage compared to the size of the house. So I do agree with some of the other board members on that aspect as well. That's all my comments.
All right. Thanks, Nick. Perhaps a little bit of my comments go somewhat toward having, we were out at the property earlier. Actually, you were getting in the car while I was standing across the street.
You were across the street?
All right. So we had a chance to take a look at it. But besides that, the first criteria is, and second criteria called for under chapter 10, is really where you have to provide some compelling evidence here. And it comes down to, due to the size, shape, and topography of the property, there is no other location to site this development other than where you proposed it without further encroaching on other setbacks. So it really has to be, this is the only place you can put it with relief from the board because of the layout, the shape, size, and topography of the property. You make mention of the lot lines, they're not parallel. That's not a grounds for a variance. Variances are really tough to get because they last forever. The Aquifer Protection District, you're learning, is a very difficult area in town, and it covers quite a bit of the area of this town. But the district is in place for a reason, to protect that recharge for the aquifers that haven't been in use in this town since it went on town water and sewer, but because that's our backup, if you will, and is still protected. Those are the types of things that the town wants to mandate homeowners comply with. It requires a lot of jumping through hoops, unfortunately, but it's there for a reason. And so that's what the board is alluding to when we hammer on the Aquifer Protection District. Having been out to the property, it's a large structure which is right flush with the front of the house, so it's going to be right on the street. Going up to the, from the diagram, the elevation drawings that you provided, the top of the roof is probably flush with the top of your upper story windows. So it's going to be a sizable structure from a height and extending your building. I don't technically we like to try to be helpful, but I don't know, you know, for me that provides a large massing of property that I'm not sure is in character with that neighborhood. I live right around the corner. Well, not too far away. on the other side of Home Goods, behind you. But that massing structure, in addition to your house, essentially right off the street, is enormous. You know, it's pretty big, and so that, again, in keeping with substantial derogation, that condition, that criteria, substantial derogation to the bylaw on the public good, which we're charged with, that causes me some concern as well. The criteria with regard to the shape and topography, we've gone over that. The financial hardship, I guess, is probably up to the subjective, up to the members of the board, whether looking at that objective criteria. Each member has a vote, you need 4 out of 5. There are more than that here tonight, but there'll be 5 of us voting. You need 4 out of 5 to vote in your favor. That said, given the couple of shortcomings in the information that you provided, I don't know that the board is prepared to vote on a complete application tonight. The aquifer protection question, issue the plot plan, were we to grant your application, we have to stamp that plot plan and that gets recorded, and where it's not complete, in keeping with the zoning enforcement officer's requirements, we couldn't vote on it because it's not complete. It doesn't show the impervious cover. that's something that if you're indeed in the aquifer protection district, as the building inspector opines, that you'll need to settle. So I don't think you want, well, we can't vote tonight. The board has given you some feedback that will give you some few minutes to think about while we go through the next procedural portion of the hearing, and then we'll come back at the end, and I think what we're gonna do, presuming you're in agreement and the other board members are, is to probably ask you to come back after having done a few things to make your application a little bit more complete. You're here tonight, we're here tonight.
Yeah.
Okay? If you want us to vote on the application, we could vote on it, but we don't have enough information to make an approval necessarily of the application. So I think you know, it's incomplete, candidly. But with that said, you know, I echo a number of what, you know, Robert and John had to say, and everybody had to say, included. So what I'll do is I will, before I go into, I'm gonna open the hearing up to public comment. Not a lot of folks here, one gentleman here, but while I do that, I will note that we have letters of support, both dated January 11th, 2017, from neighbors on either side of you, a neighbor at 263 Franklin and 273 Franklin, which I'm guessing are either side of you, that are in support of the relief that you're seeking, and those will be made part of the record. Would you like to speak, sir?
Just
before you speak, sir, you must be sworn and identify yourself for the record.
Okay.
Testimony given before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you may want to speak, please stand and raise your right hand, sir. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Response is, I do.
I do.
Thank you, sir. Please identify yourself for our recording secretary, name and address.
Name is Jill Lennart, L-A-N-A-R-T. Property on Leavenworth Avenue.
Thank you, sir. The floor is yours.
Which does reside in the aquifer protection zone. I have no specific opinions or standing relative to this gentleman's submission. I had one question of clarification, though, at minimum. Mr.
Redfern.
My understanding were decks were not considered impervious surface relative to the aquifer protection. It might be a misunderstanding, but I thought decks were not the same as driveways, etc. It'd only make a difference if, you know, we're doing the, if it comes out of that 15% where, you know, a deck has it over or not. So I guess I can go back and look.
Mm-hmm.
But when I asked downstairs once with the enforcement officer, I may have incorrectly gotten the wrong impression about decks relative to hard surfaces. So that was just one main question of clarification. I think my other comments or concerns would have to knock for protection, but I don't think it's a good use of time here now to discuss that, because again, I don't think it has any relevance to this specific application. And it's more about the process, procedures, and the getting at the intent of the 15% rule to protection, and whether an artificial recharge mechanism is a reasonable, explicit requirement, or if the intent should be that the property's topology, permeability, landscaping, terrain, et cetera, if it meets the end of getting good water to be absorbed into the ground to get to and in a reservoir, I think that would be better than, for example, just having it run off into the street and go away for a property that's different. So again, I think that's a distraction. So one question.
Your concerns are not uncommon with folks that live in the Aquifer Protection District. The town has been, wards and departments have been addressing or trying to address the frustrations of and concerns of residents in the Aquifer Protection District regarding standards, fixes, artificial management programs, perhaps pervious pavers, those types of things as a means for recharge. My understanding is if water can't freely run through it, it's considered cover. So whether or not I'm 100% sure of that, I can't sit here and tell you. But it would be a good idea to confirm that if you have concerns with the building department or community services, they'd be able to tell you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
You mentioned recharge systems of some sort of artificial.
Artificial.
Is that something that you could, I mean, if you're over the percentage, is that something you could add to, and that would you know, be a recharge that would help you?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, we've had other applicants come in and actually in the Aquifer Protection District have to install a groundwater recharge system.
Okay.
So it's basically like letting the runoff from
big dry well kind of thing.
Roof, from your driveway, etc. You collect it and then recharge it through an engineered system back into the ground, as opposed to, as that gentleman said, letting it run off into the streets.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, Robert. All right, so I'll go ahead and close the public portion of our hearing tonight. Before we move on, do any of the board members have any further comment for the applicant?
I would just have one. In my view, it appears to me that where it is probably, in my opinion, the best place to put it on the property, the garage. Second opinion is, it's too big. In my view, to make the whole thing work somehow, it's gotta be a smaller garage, okay? And the other thing is the AQ issue. Those are the three things, but in terms of advice to you, my advice to you from this one individual would be, it's gotta be smaller. And I think trying to put it somewhere else on that property is going to be tougher and not as attractive to the neighborhood as that location that it's at now. That's my personal opinion.
Thank you. Thank you, Cy.
I would agree with Cy on that, mm-hmm. And I think that is probably the most feasible location for it, that side next to your kitchen, etc. Again, I think it's something you should look at in regards to reducing the size. If you can get that reduced so that you meet the side yard setbacks, you would not even have to be before this board. You would just deal with the building inspector then and satisfy him to get your permit. You would not have to get a permit or a variance from this board at all.
Well, still have to deal with probably the Aquifer Protection area,
but that's
you'll
something
do that
he
through community
deal.
Services and the engineering department.
That's something
department.
He would
deal with
the building inspector. And if, in fact, then he needs a, or if he's looking for a variance from the criteria of the Aquifer Protection, then he would come to the board for that.
Perhaps.
But right now, he's not looking for any variance from the Aquifer Protection requirements.
Right.
He's looking for a variance for side yard setback. Yeah.
Right.
Assuming that you could, that the AQ issue resolves itself,
right.
And we don't know that.
We don't, no.
You could take 500 square feet off that structure right now, and you wouldn't be here.
Right.
You could have a 13.3 garage by
yep.
The other thing, and you wouldn't have to be here.
John?
I agree with both Cy and Robert. If it were smaller and it complied, then the only thing we'd be talking about, and maybe not even talking about, is qualification under the Aquifer Protection criteria. And if that is met, then you don't even need to come before this board. I would also tell you that, especially within the last, I'm gonna say, couple years, the character of the neighborhood is becoming more and more important because there's no more land to build on. So people have to keep with some degree of acceptability to the rest of the neighborhood, what is being built there or being rebuilt there. So I think that that is a major issue, and that this board has not given out variances easily.
I can tell.
It's the nature of the law itself.
I understand.
Meeting the all four criteria is difficult. I would tell you also, too, that the Aquifer Protection District represents, just by looking at the zoning map, represents probably visually about 20% of the town in area, not necessarily in area where people are living, but it is a major issue. And it was adopted a number of years ago for the most important issue to us humans who live there, and that is quality water. And if we can't have quality water, you don't live without getting infected in some form or manner. So, as the rest of the board members mentioned, if you can cut that down and comply, then we're only looking at the aquifer area. And by cutting it down, you also reduce the number of, potentially the numbers that you're going in to qualify for the criteria for the Aquifer Protection District. So I mean, we're going to have to move to a time certain in the future to do this, and that's going to be a big question for the applicant. How far ahead does he want to plan this to come back to the board?
Right. So you have some choices. You could ask us for a vote. You've already heard from us that we don't think we're prepared to make a vote, or to have a vote, because we don't think the file is complete. You could request a continuance to put information together, talk with your team, with your family, and have some time to provide information to come back before the board at a later date with the same similar request for a variance, because you want the garage to encroach into the side yard setbacks. During the time, or you could request right now to withdraw your application without prejudice, to refile it at a later time, although you've already gone through the steps to file the application and be heard, but it is an option available to you. In which case the matter would be administratively at least closed while you conference with your folks and decide if you even want to come back here. Now, I suppose you could also do that during the time you have a continuance, and if during that time you decide differently, you can contact the town and get taken off the agenda and request a withdrawal, which the board would then have to grant, obviously, but that's what you want, we can give you that. Given those choices, do you have a preference?
Yeah, I think at least at this point, do a continuance and then decide, okay. You know, go back and I'll decide what,
very good.
What we want to do. It makes most sense.
Very good.
To do that.
So now the next part is picking a date for you to come back. May 11th, is I don't think a good date for you to come back, because we have a 40B hearing that night and they've just added in a second case to be heard following that 40B hearing. A 40B hearing is a affordable housing hearing that typically is
that's going to go a long time.
robust in terms of information being presented. So that'll be a long night, I think, already with an additional case from another applicant that got squeezed in. So I think we're looking at May 18th. Does that night work for you? I mean, certainly you can tell us now that it does, and if it doesn't, you can contact.
That's roughly 4 weeks. And the question is, can your team come back with the criteria, or do you need a little bit more time to do that?
No, I think, no, I think they probably could, but it's just, I have a conflict that evening.
Okay. June 1st would be the next date available. That's about 6 weeks out.
That's fine.
June 1st? All right. So, the applicant has requested a continuance from June 1st to June 1st, and we would probably just need a motion and a vote to confirm the applicant's request for a continuance. Would somebody like to make a motion?
So moved.
Okay. Do we have a second?
Second.
Kathy?
Kathy.
All right, so we have a motion to continue to June 1st with a second. Anybody have any comment on that? No? All those in favor? None opposed? All right. Thank you for your time tonight. We are continued until Thursday, June 1st.
Thank you. Appreciate the time and
thanks for your time and patience as well.
Yeah.
All right, so, you know, a couple other minor things that aren't on the agenda, but I was informed that probably by the end of summer, there will be another 40B application being filed. It's the Eaton Lakeview property behind Salem 5. The town does have a safe harbor and can reject outright 40B applications until next February, the end of next February. And so between now and then, the town will determine, and the board can, you know, has the option, we can certainly consult with town council on this as to what, you know, is the best thing for the board to do. Now, I will say that I will be recusing myself from any hearing on that 40B application. I have a professional conflict. The applicant is a client. And so John will, as the vice chair, will take over as chair to hear that 40B when and if it does come down the pike. So I just want to fill you in on that. Let's see, what else? John and I had a meeting with a couple of members of the CPDC and Gene and Julie the other night to discuss the warrant article that we touched upon last time. After much discussion and what I think it came down to is for, and again in my opinion, which was perhaps shared, if not totally adopted by some of those there, the piecemeal permit granting authority that would result from the zoning change would result in confusion and lack of continuity for people coming in with accessory apartment applications. So it was my suggestion that permit granting authority reside for all accessory apartments either with one board or the other. You know, we're trying to simplify where applicants have to go. You know, it would seem a little bit contrary to the town's intent to have one applicant for one section of the bylaw go to one board, one applicant for other sections of the bylaw come to another board. And so the result is that on the floor of town meeting, I will request an amendment, whether it's considered friendly or otherwise, to the table of uses to revert permit granting authority back to the ZBA for all accessory apartment applications, detached, attached, and otherwise. We'll see how that goes. I didn't get any feedback, and John can correct me here, that the CPDC, who is the sponsor of the article, would oppose that. And whether or not they support it or not, I guess we'll find out at town meeting, which starts next Monday. I don't know if I'll be heard on Monday or if that article will come up on Monday, but it's a packed town meeting. I imagine it'll be a short conversation on the floor.
I think I would concur that I thought that the feeling of the two members of the CPDC who were there, who also felt that it's difficult to have continuity if you're splitting that up. And if, as we talked about our last meeting, if you're going to base it on the character of the neighborhood and whatever, they should really be hearing a great deal of the 5.0 sections, and that was not, I think, where they were coming from. So I think that I didn't hear anything about not supporting that. In fact, it was just a question of how best to do that before town meeting.
Yep. I am I'm on the motion list, the amendment list for town meeting, so we've taken care of that. Other than that, I imagine we'll hear within the next couple of weeks from town council about the substance of the next 40B continuance for the St. Agnes piece. Last hearing, one of the peer review consultants couldn't make it. The board left the applicant with, I think, some questions to answer. So whether or not I think it was the engineering peer review. Maybe I was wrong. I think it was engineering peer review got stuck and couldn't make the hearing. But whether he's going to submit a written application and a written submission in response to findings, or whether or not he's going to come and testify, remains to be seen. So that's about all the information I have to share. I did send out, and the town sent out, some renewal notices to a few of the members of the board. Hope you'll re-up. So Nick did. So that's good. So Cy and Kathy, search your soul. hope you'll, you know, I guess May 8th is the deadline to get that back one way or the other. But we hope you'll stay on, because we like working with you.
We seem to work well together as a unit.
Yeah.
At the same time.
We do pretty
well. If I do it, I'll do it for one more time. At that point, I'll be too old.
At that point.
Where is that in the definition, sir? Yeah.
I don't know, but I can't remember anything that I did yesterday anymore. But anyway, no, I will probably re-up for another.
Thanks for sharing that, Cy. That's a uniquely personal decision to share.
I hear rumors about whether it might be shifting from Thursdays to Wednesdays. Where does that stand?
Okay.
Yeah.
So
yes.
I did pass, well, last time we were at the hearing, Cy and Kathy weren't here. Right. So I did reach out to you separately to ask if there was any particular reason why Wednesday might not work. So to go back to the why, for budgetary and staffing concerns, and with Maureen Knight retiring and perhaps coming back on a part-time basis after her retirement, the town has decided to shift some staffing around, and we'll be hiring a new administrative liaison. Did I get that right, Kim?
Thank
you. Who will be assigned to ZBA business and perhaps another board's business. And as such, they thought that from a time, overtime, time commitment standpoint, and just logistically, meaning with hearings on Thursday nights, there's nobody around Friday to answer any questions because town hall's closed, or to do anything with anything that's going on tonight, tomorrow. Secondarily, they would do sort of a staggered schedule, or propose a staggered schedule to that staff person to have them work perhaps from 2 to 10, you know, 1 to 9, to try to alleviate the overtime burden and have that staff person assigned on Wednesday. That happens to be a night that perhaps is somewhat open, and perhaps two boards or committees could be heard on, you know, first and third Wednesday is ZBA, second and fourth is, I think they mentioned maybe CONCOM or another board. And that liaison person could be, that could be their staggered day, so there's some continuity for that person's life as well, that they know, you know, on Wednesdays I'm working 2 to 10, So Gene asked me to see what we thought about it. At our last hearing, none of the members voiced any objection. I mean, it's, you know, no better than Thursday, no worse. And so I passed it on to Cy and to Kathy. I think you both got back and said, no better, no worse. So so I think we're, the board is in agreement that we could change to Wednesday if the daytime government asks us to. And we'll wait to hear from them as to whether or not that's when and if that's actually going to happen. So, you know, team players.
There wasn't a date to which they thought that that may happen, though. That wasn't assigned yet, was it, Kim?
To a person?
No. I mean, the date were...
Switching to Wednesdays?
Right.
No, I think they're waiting to hire somebody.
Hire somebody
right,
first,
yeah,
right.
Right, yeah. They need somebody in that position first before they assign them to us and change the day. So I imagine we'll get some notice, hopefully, to allow us to rearrange our live, you know, to make sure that we are, have a quorum here on Wednesday hearings. So.
Well, certainly not going to be before June 1.
No, I can't imagine it would be. I would
continue the hearing to June 1.
If I had a guess, I would think probably by the fall, but I could be wrong. But whenever it is, I'm sure we'll know. And if I learn before anybody else, I'll certainly share it with everybody. But I imagine we'll get some sort of a notice. Hey, we're changing you up, and welcome to the new person, and the new person will be your liaison. I think they're anticipating, and talking with Gene, that that person will be someone who also, you know, can act as the ex officio, you know, staff daytime government liaison to the board. You know, for instance, during CPDC meetings, Gene or Julia, or Gene and Julia are there as, you know, senior staff members. I don't know that we'll get either one of them because their plates are full. And while we're sad to lose perhaps Kim when that happens, that we'll have somebody that also can and will, not unlike what Kim does, you know, act as a ex officio member of the board, you know, just by virtue of their position.
All right, well, like we used to have Glenn.
Right.
Since he retired and just is on a part-time basis.
Right.
Now.
He was the senior
right.
staff member, daytime staff member that sat ex officio on the board. So we'll see what happens there. I mean, that's, you know, if that helps the town budgetary-wise and helps to streamline things, then go for it. Anything else? No? All right. Next hearing is May 11th. Take a motion to adjourn. Second? John? All those in favor? We are adjourned. Thanks, everybody.
Good thing.